Like, you just feel like there's so much going on. It's overwhelming. It's fun. It's a bit stressful. You feel like you have your head around it, and then it's like, oh, POAP and DAOs, and it's like, wow, like.
Hey, Panini, don't you be a meanie. Thought you wanted me to go, or why you trying to keep me teeny? It's a dreamy, wished it on a genie.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to the first episode of the NFT Show. We've decided to come together. Michael Piccoli, Mike Su, and today's special guest, Danielle Weber. We've got a lot to talk to you about with everything that's been going on with you in the NFT space, but we decided to put this show together because we feel like there is, it's so new. The space is ridiculously new. There's so much happening, I think, from a day-to-day basis. Like, in NFT world, 1 week feels like 2 months. There's that much going on, and I know it's really hard to keep on top of absolutely everything, and there's so much information out there and people trying to put dots together, how Web3 works, what's a MetaMask wallet, what minting terms are, all the new slang that comes with it. It's daunting. You can get lost in this world. So I think this was perfect, Mike. I think you pushed this last week. You said, Christian, we got to rock and roll here. So it's amazing to have you guys on board in this, and it's going to be fun. It's going to be interesting. So, like, thank you for joining us. How are we all feeling about this?
Go for it.
Good. I think it's a new chapter, and I think it's part of just shining the light on this space, especially to people who aren't as technically savvy and haven't dived in quite yet. So I think it's important for us to just help spread the message through this podcast, through the Collings NFT Instagram page. Follow, like a post.
Subscribe.
Already a plug. We're a minute in and we're already plugging it. I love it. But I think, Danielle, like, we've discussed previously in podcasts how, you know, you got involved because of art, but how have you found it?
I think, as you mentioned, one of the biggest words is daunting. It's it's been a wild ride. And I think, as you said too, like, 1 week feels like months, and it feels like we've been like researching this for years, and it really has just, it's just a whirlwind. So yeah, I'm still really excited about the space. I think for me, I just always find myself going down these new rabbit holes. You know, even yesterday trying to purchase the book games, I was just like clicking all these buttons and all these gas fees were going everywhere. And I was like, oh, there's another $70. There's another $100. And no idea what I was doing. I'm like signing up to all these different wallets. I have stuff everywhere. And that's probably a good representation of anyone who's new to the field. Like, you just feel like there's so much going on. It's overwhelming. It's fun. It's a bit stressful. You feel like you have your head around it, and then it's like, oh, POAP and DAOs, and it's
there's
like
a new term.
Wow, like there's like 400 new words that I need to learn. So
diamond hands.
Yeah, hold I haven't even heard that one.
Hold on to those book games.
Far out.
Don't sell.
Wild. Yeah. So I think that's me trying to wrap it up in a nutshell. There's so much going on in all of our heads, but that's me. And then aside from the whirlwind that I've gone through with my own collections and my own journey and creating these pieces and figuring out what's right and wrong and trying to please everyone and while staying true to your own craft. And yeah, so that's a whole nother can of worms.
It's crazy. I think, Michael, you've been in the space for a couple of years. I think you got burnt. And I had to drag you back in. No. NFT wise.
Yeah, we got scarred pretty
hard. No, I didn't know
he was scarred. Yeah. For months I was trying to pull him. I'm like,
yeah, it was bad.
You're like, no. Far out. I didn't even know that. Yeah, look at you now. You're like keen as a bean, like nothing happened. How good.
Oh, Mikey's coming up with crazy ideas.
Yeah, now
half
now
an hour
now
ago
now
he just
pulled back into it. We're like full degen, like another
that's
term.
So cool.
He just pulled something half an hour ago, which we'll talk about a bit later.
Okay.
Genius. I was already on the phone trying to make calls, trying to figure out how we're going to do this. Like, this is genius. Subi, you're going to love this one.
Wow. Can't wait.
Yeah.
We haven't told
him
about our little idea either.
There's just so much. Everything's up for grabs in this NFT world. But
yeah,
Mikey, what's your little journey?
Well, firstly, good morning, everyone. Yeah, so I got into crypto. I was gaming and hanging out with some interesting people on the internet. I've always been like part of like chat rooms, all that kind of stuff, and came across Bitcoin in like 2015, I think it was.
Yeah.
And then finally bought in in 2016, I bought my first Bitcoin for like, I think it was like 250, 260 USD or something.
Wow.
And then sold it, bought in again in like 2017, I think it was. And every week I was just seeing like, I bought it in again at like, I think it was 6,000 USD. And then like every week I had like, or every night I had like $1,000 just like going up in my wallet. It got like to an insane amount, and then yeah, we got burnt extremely hard.
Oh no.
We literally had diamond hands while the thing was shipping. I was watching my balance go from like a pretty like decent amount to the, just keep going down and down and down. And I was just like, I'm not selling. I'm like in it for the long run. And then I sold at the very bottom because I needed the money.
Paper hands, mate.
Yeah.
Paper hands.
I held the whole time. Like I could have.
Don't take note.
And my mate told me when I first got in the space in 2015, he said, and he's like a millionaire now, he said to me, never sell, always hold. Yeah. Like never sell. And I was like listening to the advice all the way up until I actually had to sell because I had no like,
yeah,
no like fiat money. Mm-hmm. So I was like, I had to sell so I could like actually get myself through some shit. And yeah, we sold at the complete bottom, like 3,000 USD.
And here we are. So we pulled you back in.
Yeah, now we're back in.
Now we got him back. Yeah. Book games. He made a few bucks yesterday. He's back ready to go.
We saw an opportunity.
Yeah. Well, it's interesting because my entry to the space was 2017. I literally probably jumped in 2 weeks before the crash, 3 weeks. I was late, extremely late to the party. I bought this coin, Myota. Pretty much bought it at the top. I think it was like $7 or something, and just lost that. That went gone. Then I bought some Cardano, which I never sold. And I remember in January of 2020 last year, I was like, let me have a look, like, because there was like a little boom over that time. And I think I had like a couple $1,000 in there. I was like, oh wow, okay. So we've lost like $5,000. We've claimed about 1,000, 2,000 here. So let's just jump in and diving in and actually understanding what this space is about, and everything that's going on, and how many industries NFTs or you know smart contracts are changing or bringing in new systems to make the world, I don't know, businesses run better, more smoothly. It's crazy. So yeah, very, very interesting, especially just NFTs. Like when that came about, I think May or June is when I stumbled across it and just understood, you know, what opportunities are here from people creating PFP projects that are going to turn that into a game or turn that into a TV show, which is going to be in 20 years time, the next, you know, the next Disney or the next Simpsons or games, where people are now creating games that within 10 years time, it could potentially become a AAA game where it's, you know, a Grand Theft Auto, or just companies that have started ticketing, yeah, where they're putting all tickets onto the blockchain, and you know now it's going to give you know companies like Ticketek a chance to make royalties because if the tickets are NFTs on the blockchain, if they ever swap wallets, they'll make money. So it's crazy. There's opportunities. I'm seeing opportunities everywhere. Like I said 30 minutes ago, we came up with a crazy idea, and everything's up for grabs. Sumi, you've been I think in the space as well. Did you hang around? I mean, so were you in 2017, 2018 or?
Yeah, a little bit. I didn't have much money back then.
Yeah.
Just a broke uni student, so didn't have much to put in, but I was. And I think like the space is like developing so quickly, like people are in general getting smarter. Like in 2017, like the average person had no idea about Bitcoin or how to buy Bitcoin or anything like that. Now, like most people kind of have a rough idea. And I kind of see like NFTs and the NFT space kind of like the app space like 10 years ago where like people were creating apps just to make apps because that was like the big thing, sell it on the app store, make, you know, add money and that stuff. And now it's like NFTs is like the fad. NFTs is like the apps of those days. But now you're seeing apps like Uber become like proper full companies. Like at its core, Uber is still just an app. Mm. But I think that's the way the NFT space is going to go eventually as well. We're just not going to call it NFTs. It's just going to be like in the system, kind of like how apps are kind of like just in the system now.
Yeah.
It'll be interesting. It'll be definitely interesting to see how this space evolves. Cause really like with NFTs, I'd say we're Bitcoin 2011, where it's so early, it's so small, where things are going to be just, they're kicking off. A lot of people are opening up these things, as you said, because it's easy to do. And then, you know, but it's going to be around. Are they going to hold up in a couple of years' time? Are they going to be around, or are a lot of these people just cash grabs? Which that's a massive thing, because it's so easy to put up a roadmap, you know, and just say we're going to be doing this. But that's one thing I can see. There's going to be a big NFT crash, where, you know, Gary Vee talks about it all the time. He reckons 98-99% of these are going to go to zero. So I think that's generally going to happen. There's a lot of money flying around at the moment, where things are just going bonkers. Like a lot of the stuff as well, it's all just hearsay. It's all ideas and it's all marketing, and it's all, they're blowing up and they're getting crazy valuations, but these things aren't worth really anything. So it's going to be crazy to see how this place evolves. But I think the tech and everything about it, it's hanging around and it's going to be nuts. And Danielle, like you, did you lose it all in 2017?
I don't think I can resonate with you guys. Sorry.
Lucky.
Sorry. I bought in 2018 or 2017 actually, probably, but I held for long game. So it could have been 2018. I think I bought, like, my main holding was Cardano at like 11 cents or something. So whenever that was, could have been 2018. I haven't, like, even when it's dropped massively, I've just left it in. Sorry, Mikey. Sorry. Yeah. Looking at you over there.
It's like crying soon.
But in saying that, I feel like I had no idea what I was doing. So for me, I was just like, well, I don't really care for it or know any different anyway. So the fact that I was so sort of detached from it at that point was probably lucky, in a sense that I didn't just freak out. And my ignorance was kind of bliss in that sense. Yeah. But I still play around with like a lot of different coins and have no idea what I'm doing, and it's great fun. So I'm sure I will lose at some point. Yeah. Some of the stuff that I did buy has gone to zero, but I've made up for it in other like coins. So it's fine. But definitely some of them, I'm like, whoop, don't know what I was thinking there. Whoopsies. Because like I literally used to go through the lists and like just be like, oh, that sounds cool. And like had no idea. Like I liked the name of it, and I just like
all put the money logo. In that.
Yeah. And I'm like, cool logo too. Yeah. And so I'm like, and that's probably, you know, we tell people to make educated decisions in NFTs, and, you know, look at the community, like go into the Discord, like get a feel for what they're about and what meme, you know, what they're bringing to the table. And still I see NFTs, I'm like, ooh, that looks cool.
Yeah.
Like, just buy it. And I'm just like, I literally tell people not to do this, and I still get like caught up in doing that. So I think that's the fun of it, and I'm not too fast. I think like anything I've said to people, I'm like, if you're going to do it, like, you know, at the end of the day it is money, like you can lose it, it's quite volatile, so as long as you're aware of that, then
I think it's something, just play with money that you can afford to lose, just
of course,
and just understand that once it's going in, it's, you know, there's a high chance of you're gonna lose it all, but there's a good chance as well you can make some money. And you know, I think it's you got to play, like you got to play to get a feel of the space and understand, you know, and really spend a lot of time, you know, in communities. But my biggest thing for me when I'm looking for a project is who's behind it. Yeah. And a lot of them, they hide their identities. They don't want to put themselves out there. If they're doing that, that's a massive red flag to me. You know, and I always look at the founder, and I always say to myself, okay, what have they done? What have they achieved? Like, what businesses have they run before? Because really what NFTs are, that you're investing in businesses.
Yeah.
So it's, if they've got a good track record, I go for it. What are some other things that you guys look for when looking for a project?
I like to say that I actually like the project. Mm. But I feel like the projects that I like from like a just first glance kind of appearance at the actual art doesn't do well. And the stuff that I think, oh, that's not the best art, ends up being like the highest selling project of all time.
It's so hard to pick
that,
isn't
it?
Yeah,
so I don't tend to use like my opinion in that regard as a determinant if I'll buy in. For me, it's community, it's Twitter. Like I feel like there's certain like people in Twitter who just have like whatever they say just goes. Like any project they promote just tends to fly. So I tend to just stay on Twitter, look at what people are saying about projects. If I think the utility is really cool, or the concept and idea behind it, then I think those projects do well as well. Like for example, LinkStyle was one that I fell in love with, and then I accidentally missed the bloody mint because I had COVID. No. I know, I'm spewing. That was the DAO to buy golf courses and make it like a country club, and exclusive access via the NFT.
Yeah.
So I thought that was like super cool.
Yeah.
The utility don't even like insane. Golf, but I just thought thought it was like really mad.
Yeah.
And I think it minted at 0.05 and now it's for sale at 1 ETH.
Wow. So it's already. And how long's that been?
A week.
Yeah, that's crazy.
That's crazy.
It's nuts. Yeah. Don't get COVID next time.
It happens.
Duh.
It happens.
Yeah, I was I'm going to take a break for a week. And then in a week, all these projects launched that I wanted to buy, they all flew up. And I'm just like, don't ever take a break again.
Yeah. Nah, there's no pausing in this community. Yeah. In this world. Like, there's no chill. Yeah. Like, that was like me. I was like, I'm going to go away and switch off. And then I didn't have any internet. And everyone's just like, where are you? Like, you haven't been on Twitter. And I'm like, oh, my God. Like, I'm sorry. I had
it's a rug.
3 days off. Like, it's pretty. And, like, I think that's the beauty of the community. Though. Like, everyone's, like, keeps everyone accountable and in the loop. And everyone communicates really well. And that's probably another way that you can find out about projects is, like, I've just been talking to people in the space. Like, you link up on Twitter and you're like, hey, like, what are you like? Yeah. And just like, I was going to buy something and this guy's like, nah, don't, like, something happened with the project. Like, gave me a heads up that it was a bit dodgy. And I was like, cool. Like, so I just sort of, you just listen to who's been in the space, you know, there's people changing careers left, right and center and like fully diving in, like quitting their jobs. And I tend to like listen to those people because they're so dedicated as well. So I'm like, wow, like that's
a full-time passion. Job. It's a lifestyle.
Yeah.
It is.
Yeah. So that's definitely another way to pick your projects as well.
What do you reckon, Sumi? What do you got for us?
I don't even know how to pick them. I just know that it's better to be lucky than to be smart in the NFT space sometimes.
Okay.
Good call, fair call.
Okay.
Yeah. I think that what you said, CJ, about like having some, I still struggle to sort of, not support, but like when I don't know who is behind it and they're literally just these massive projects. Or there's no depth and meaning. I guess me as a creator, like I've always tried to create work that people can connect to or feel something on the other end or holds meaning to me or someone else or their journey. So when there's literally just like things being churned out and you don't know who's behind it or perhaps there is no meaning, I do struggle a little bit. But again, people can connect on a visual element as well. So like I've got a whole heap of those, not the bored apes, but the grandpa apes.
Yeah.
And they're still chill. Like I fully believe that project's going to blow up, but we'll hold tight. But like I've got all these just like these funny little grandpas. Like I'm like, they're mad dogs. Like they're my spirit animals. Yeah. Like, so I like connected with them and I've done some research into the community and like the Discord's awesome as well. So, yeah, so that's probably a few different, like from a creator's standpoint, I do struggle sometimes to comprehend, but I'm definitely learning. So,
We'll get there. I think you look at like Shiba Inu, if you put in $1,000 in Jan 2021, it'd be worth $6 billion or something today.
Crazy.
And that goes back to your point, Sumu, like you'd be done $6 billion just by putting $1,000 into it. So there are those opportunities, but very hard to find. Very hard to find.
Coulda, shoulda, woulda.
Yeah. Very hard to find. So I'm sure we're gonna be hearing some more crazy stories. Already bought apes. People have minted them for $200, selling them for $1 million, $2 million in 5-6 months.
You just watched my grandpa apes come through.
So like there's this. It's so early. This is, as I said, Bitcoin 2011. That there are those crazy opportunities. But yeah, just Piccoli, what was your first NFT that you purchased?
Why
did you buy it?
So for someone who loves the space so much, the one thing I hate is like the barrier of entry. It's so expensive. Like you hear, oh, it's 0.2 of an ETH to buy into the project. And then you do the maths and it's like that's 2,000 Australian dollars, like a couple of months ago. I think now it's like 1,000. So
yeah,
like just, it's a lot of money. Like you have to kind of be prepared to just say, I'll never see that money again.
Because
God knows if the project's a rug or if something happens and no one wants to buy it, you can't sell it, you can't recoup the money. It's got a big barrier of entry, which is one thing I don't like. So I took my time to buy my first project, but my first one was the US Open token.
Okay, wow. Yeah. Right. Oh,
so,
yeah, wow.
I'm a big lover of sport and that one there was like $50. So I was like, yeah, I'm going to buy it.
Yeah.
Now I'm in. But besides that, the Book Games NFT was my first one.
Okay.
My first like actual like project was the Book Games NFT and I got lucky with that one. Sold at a peak, I think. I'm going to say it was a peak. Now I'm looking for other projects that are going to be like that 0.2 mark now that I've got a bit of money to play around with and try and find that one that's going to 10, 20X and just try and...
Grandpa apes.
Danielle just chilling her project.
That's crazy. Nah. My first one was NBA Top Shot, LeBron James.
Cool.
I think that was a Feb last year. And then my first like NFT on the Ethereum blockchain was the Zed Run, the horses.
Yeah.
The first drop. So got one of those. I've never raced it. I've never raced the horse.
Just hold them and see.
Yeah, it. I just held. I don't know. I don't even.
They'll be old and wise. And
yeah,
just
yeah. So that was that was really cool. But yeah, Sumi, what was your first?
Mom, if you're watching this, turn it off. I spent like $700 on this pretty garbage project. It's pretty much worth nothing now. I think it's called Lords of Light. And
sounds cool.
Yeah, I minted it and then I'm like, okay, fingers crossed. And then I check back a couple months later.
Go
like, this is, no one even plays it. The project's just been abandoned. So
should have bought a Danielle's artwork.
Yeah, literally.
Oh, just kidding. It's right. Yeah, I know. Well, shit, we thought it would be in everyone's price range. Then it just went to the moon straight away. So, my bad. I can't even afford my own work. Yeah. is that. Are you done?
Yeah.
I'm done. So, my first NFT was, I don't even know how it came up. I think it was on my Instagram and I saw this. It's like a 3D motion digital. I think they're like musician as well. I don't know too much about the artist, but it's called One Robot. And I'd just never seen anything like it. I connected to the piece. It was like a body with like pieces through it, but it's like gold and it's like so cool. And it was 3D art and I'd never like bought anything like that. So that was my first, I think it was like $1,000 maybe. And it's definitely, it's gone down a bit, but they've held like, and it was I've got one of 22.
Nice.
So, that was my first one. And then I've got like a few projects that I've just supported some artists having a crack, like really like small projects, but I'm just like, their work's so cool. So I'm not planning to like flip any of them. But then I've got like some Cosmic Cowgirls and I'm just like, they're girls, so mad.
Yeah.
Like, cool. And then
we'll just go with it.
Yeah. And then I've got like 8 of my little grandpa friends. And then I've got, what else do I have? And then I've got the Book Games. I bought 9.
Nice.
And I got, yeah. So
anyone's worth like hundreds of thousands?
I didn't get in nor. Could have, but I didn't. Nah, just kidding. Nah. I just got a whole heap of like, I think one of them had a bit more of a rare property, but most of them were just like mid.
Pretty, yeah. That was kind of mine as well.
Yeah.
Talking about Book Games, that was crazy. So Gary V, he's got a project, V Friends, and V Friends was going back to probably what you were talking about before, Michael, him just drawing, doodling on a paper and selling the art, and you know, I think the floor price is sitting at 13.5 ETH, which was like 50,000 Australian or something like that. And everyone's been shitting on him, saying, "What is that artwork?" And it goes back to my point, it's about the person behind it who's just creating magic. And I always I reference this as well, go on Google and search The Simpsons first edition, and we'll probably just put it up here so you can have a look. And the Simpsons first edition is just like this really bad cartoons of Homer, yeah, and Bart,
oh my God,
and things like that. So I know like the V Friends, if it becomes what it becomes, it's crazy historical significance to have the actual doodles of
that
the characters.
That just gave me a wild idea.
Yeah. Yeah. It's crazy.
To like NFT my first like drawings when I was a kid.
Correct. Yeah, correct. 100%. Yeah. Like there's, you know, there's for Dolce & Gabbana, they sell like their product, they sold it as an NFT as well, and they attach the sketches of the product that they created and things like that. So it's
so cool.
Yeah, it's really cool. So I think that's the whole reason why he's done that, because if he builds, you know, what he's trying to do is he says he's trying to build Disney. So if he builds Disney, then those things are going to be worth millions.
Yeah.
So really cool. But yeah, so going back to book games, he did a book where he did a book launch, and he attached saying, you know, every 12 books that you buy, you'll get one NFT.
Thanks for the heads up, CJ.
Yeah. So, yeah, pulled everyone in. So I'm like, really happy that it went well. So no one's chasing me down the street. But
not yet.
Yeah, not yet. But yeah, so what he did was he actually sold, by doing that, it was a really good marketing move, because he was able to get his message of his book out. But he also sold pretty much as many books as Barack Obama did on his launch, and it was one of the biggest launches ever. So he's launched these book games where there's 125,000 tokens, and it's like a strategy game. It's like he obviously got the idea from Squid Games, but now he's going to entice people and to, you know, give him tokens, and he's going to burn those tokens. So he's going to be giving CryptoPunks away. He's going to be giving Bored Apes away, things like that. So it's going to be really cool to see what he does.
Because you can actually like swap like your own NFTs with them, which is so cool.
So, and that burns them. So if you swap it, that burns them forever.
It's so crazy.
What he's doing, he's just going to be dropping how many NFTs are in circulation, which in over time is going to lift the price. So it's really cool.
So clever.
Strategy games are starting to come out this year. Wolf Game was a very interesting one. Now, that only ran for about a week. It was an NFT game where you'd buy sheep and wolves. So it was like the Farmville version of Web3. But then people were staking, and then there was a problem with the contract. So the game's been paused for a couple months, but it's coming back within the next week. So, and that in the first week, it blew up to like number one on the charts for NFTs. It was crazy. So I think we're going to be seeing a lot of strategy games coming out within this year. I don't know. What are you guys thinking of eFriends? Are we selling? Are we holding? Like what are we doing?
I'll see how it goes. I think I'm going to hold for now, but because I was a bit confused yesterday when I was buying them, I was sort of trying to buy like a selection. And then I realized when I read that you needed like 65 to, and like all of the rare ones as well, I was like, that is impossible, like not going to happen. Yeah. So I tried to get like a selection of each of the frames and the different artworks. But then when I was reading, because everyone's like, oh, that's not fair. Like it's unreachable for people. Yeah. But from the perspective, I was like, well, hang on a second. If people are like nearly at 65 and they need that one that you've got, like that's where you could get lucky, as Mike said. It is pure luck of whatever you've bought if someone needs to put that piece in their puzzle. Mm. So I'll just hold, because I think that's going to drive, like right now, I think it'll just be interesting to see if it plays out. The hype will probably go down a bit, and then I'll check them out again next week and see what happens. But just who knows? I don't know if I'm going to, haven't decided yet. What about you?
Copy Danielle.
Yeah. Whatever Danielle's doing, we're doing. That's it.
I don't know. Don't do that. Yeah. Don't be irresponsible.
I'm taking your financial advice.
Do we put a freaking tease in this? There's no financial advice.
None of this is financial advice. We're just people just talking in a mic. So.
Yeah. But no, I thought it was interesting. Like I didn't look into the game at all. Like I knew it was a game, but as soon as I saw the exchange, I was like, yeah, I saw the prices and I was like, this is just not possible. Because I think everyone's made money who bought the NFT, which is amazing. Because I think it was like $277 to buy 12 books or whatever.
Yes, so it was a win.
Yeah, and then the floor price was like 1.5 on release. So if you sold straight away, which I did. I
paper
sold
hands, man.
No, paper hands. I was like, I'll just recoup my money. And then what was funny was I had a pretty rare one. Like, I think the characteristic was like 1.6%. Okay. Had the neon border.
Oh, cool.
I actually reckon you my one.
Lucky.
Yeah,
that's good.
I actually reckon my one was sick. It was all pink.
Yeah.
With a that's pig. Cool. Yeah, it was actually pretty mad. And someone bought it, and then Gary V retweeted it.
Oh, really?
Yeah, and I saw like people had sold it like straight away on release, like 3 hours before this happened, at like 0.6, I think was the highest price.
Yeah.
And I was like, nah. I saw like a tweet from Gary. That means my one's now worth more money.
As well, yeah.
So I'll just try and sell it for an ETH. Someone else already had it for sale for an ETH as well. And then some guy bought mine. And the other guys are still available for sale right now. That's at an ETH.
So you did well.
Yeah.
You sold it out at a high.
Yeah, you did well.
We just saw an opportunity. And
that's good.
Yeah, because I don't know. It's going to be a long burn, I reckon.
I think so. It will. It's definitely
it's going to be a couple of year hold.
More.
Yeah. And yeah. I was like,
10-year hold here, Diamond Hands, I'm telling you.
And I was like, I don't have that time. Like, I'm going to try and use this to find the next project to get the 10X and that one.
Yeah.
And just keep trying to.
Yeah.
Keep trying to go up like that.
So, what are we looking at, Piccoli? What's on the radar?
So, we found this new pay to earn game. Actually, I have no idea what it's about, but Beanie tweeted it, I think, this morning or yesterday, and he's like my go-to guy. Whatever he says just like skyrockets. He's got the biggest following out of everyone on Twitter.
What do you call them, the hamburgers? Or what do you call them? You had a name for that, those people that just know everything.
And he's just super I don't know, intelligent. He's like, there's a lot of insider trading in NFTs, and he just happens to be part of every single project. So I was like, if this guy's tweeted the post, then that's my project.
Game on.
And I'm going to try and mint that one. So,
so you're going to try and mint and flip and just keep going.
Literally.
There's a lot of people minting and flipping within the week.
Always. Within the day. I think you find it with NFTs when you're watching. So there'll be a lot of hype. So, and then they won't reveal. So you'll mint, and then they won't reveal the token for a couple of days. So during those couple of days, there's a lot of hype and it goes up. So you'll generally find when they actually reveal the NFT, that's when the price drops.
Yeah.
So, if you're not in the mint, if it's a real hype mint, then you might as well just hold on and just wait, a couple of weeks or a month until it just settles down and consolidates and finds its spot, because people get burnt. I remember the biggest hype project of 2021, the Mechaverse.
That was my project.
Oh, that was Mikey's project. I'm like, this is crap, Mikey.
This
is too much hype, Mikey.
Which one's that, the Mecha?
The Mechaverse.
Yeah, these robots. And I was like, this is so cool.
Yeah. I know, they do look cool.
They looked insane. Yeah. And I was like, this is my project. I'm buying one.
What's happened with it?
Oh, it's fizzled.
Really?
Yeah, no. So at the peak, they were out. They went all the way up.
I put a bid on one the other day.
On the first day.
Lucky I didn't win it.
Man, they went up to 8-9 ETH in the first game.
It peaked to 6 ETH, and then on the reveal crashed hardcore.
Yeah.
And now they float at 1 ETH.
Okay.
Yeah, crashed hardcore. So I think that's why even hype, I try to steer away from hype projects.
Yeah.
Because there's just so much, and it's just everyone's just trying to get in, and if you don't get in, then they're buying off the open market. And then as well,
FOMO
kicks in and goes.
Don't buy on FOMO.
Yeah,
literally.
Don't.
Danielle, is there a project that you're looking at?
I'm looking at the camera. I am. It's hard at the moment for me to be able to create freely and to keep learning about new projects without my mind getting clouded. So. I'm only just in the few that I've actually bought into at the moment. I'm not really looking at too many new projects. I think when I find myself especially pre-launch of my next collection, it's a bit hard. I feel I need to put all of it in. I don't want to do anything half-assed. So at the moment I'm just I've just bought another 4 today of the same projects that I'm in. So I'm just I'm not. And what I did with crypto is I extended myself on so many coins, and I just needed to consolidate, and I've never done that. And so I'm not going to do the same yet. NFTs, just hang 10.
It's inevitable.
Yeah, not too many. Obviously, I'm on Twitter and I'm looking what's going on and jump on a few of those chats every day and see what people are talking about. But not ready to click buy now on anything new yet.
Fair. I think... probably a project.
Oh, the Australian Open one, actually. Want to get me a few balls.
I think they're minted.
Are they?
I think tomorrow. So.
No, 13th? 13.
I saw someone tweet today that like...
Really?
Yeah. I don't know. Maybe I'm wrong. I didn't check the date, but...
I applied for that. They've left me on scene.
Yeah. Well, that's going to be
just like a rock, right?
Yeah. No, he got back to me. Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
And he was, yeah, he did. So Gary's seen it. Gary's left me on scene. Yeah. It's been passed down the line. Gary's seen it and he said that he'd contact me and he never did. I still love him, Gary. Though. It's all right. And I still bought nine of your book games. Yeah. If you're watching this. So.
The king.
Yeah, Rock left me on scene, then Gary did.
Yeah.
It happens.
Yeah, that's funny.
That's
all
right.
And now this show's open too. Like, so really, I'm just not winning at all. I'm like, never. Yeah, but that's cool. I think that's a really cool project. The fact, like, seeing these massive corporations jumping on and doing these projects. Into their, like, early in the piece for them, really. Wild. And if anyone still says that it's not going to be a thing, like, you just have to look at that to be like, okay. Like, that's, yeah. So, good that they're, like, I think so all the artists that got minted, they gave $500 and then they get, like, a percentage of the NFT as well.
Oh, man.
Yeah, so they actually got paid for it and, like, they're, you know, giving opportunity to creators to do something different and sort of, like, not an easier way into NFTs, but for artists, it's a bit more daunting. They literally sort of just said, like, we're doing it for you. You just need to do the artwork. And then they've got their own NFT minted, which is so cool.
Yeah, it's so cool.
So a really good way to do it, especially for the new people in the space. Totally.
Nice. Yeah. I think there's so many of those opportunities that are coming out now. Like, there's where you can buy the NFT, which will give you money back. So that's kind of... what I'm looking into now, Decentraland, where you can buy plots of land and then, like, kind of start businesses and stuff like that within there. Or, like, I was in there playing, like, I jumped on a poker table. Yeah, in Decentraland. So it's kind of casinos and things like that. And I've been telling Nicole, digital art, so on Decentraland and Sandbox, digital clothing, I should say. On Decentraland and Sandbox, you can create your clothing and then sell it in the game, and people buying it. So it's kind of where I'm looking in at the moment. This everything's up for grabs in this place. Like there's so much.
Yeah.
It's crazy. So that's going to be huge in 2022.
Massive.
Even the Meta Heroes, they've just launched. So pretty much all the big NFT projects you're going to see this year, they're launching a coin around their NFT, and then if you stake it, you actually get paid. The coin.
Mm-hmm.
So they launched POW, and then they've also, then the Bored Apes are about to launch their coin as well. Yep. So it's going to be so cool. Like, I think that was a problem last year where we'd get caught. I'd go on a spree where I'd buy so many NFTs and then I'm like, fuck, I've got no money.
Yeah. That was me yesterday. I'm like, please.
Yeah. I'd spend it all on NFTs and I'd be like, shit, I've got no money now unless I sell, which was frustrating because I don't sell anything. Like, because it's so then, like, trying to just have that balance. I think that's really cool that you'd be able to get an income with things. Like, even what's the game I've invested in? I don't even know what it's called.
Wolfgang.
No, not Wolfgang. We were talking about it. We made a post on it accidentally and then I stumbled across it. And then I was like, oh my God, this is so cool. Poker City. That's it. So they're creating like a GTA style game where they're already selling the assets so you can buy, I don't know, anything like planes or cars. And then you can lease it out and you can make money for the businesses. So really cool.
Really cool.
Yeah. Danielle, your next drop, we're probably a couple weeks away until we're rocking.
Also, I was looking at the date on the way here. I was like, oh, yep, that's close. That's really close.
Yeah, it's
we
nuts.
We did say that. Like, Mark was like, oh, we'll do a bit later and, you know, Jan, because, like, it's going to go fast. I'm like, oh, we're going to go fast. And now I'm like, oh, shit, it's
here.
So good call, Mike. I think we're all probably pretty shocked with how the first collection went.
Yeah.
I believed in you.
Yeah. That stage is like, called it.
Yeah. I was, man. I blamed it. Nah, we're nuts. I'm just trying to play it down.
I believe in my work and I believe, like, you know, the hard work pays off and whatnot and people see, you know, the meaning behind the pieces and everything. But being such a new space, like, you kind of got to earn your stripes. Mm. That's how I feel anyway. So I'm so grateful. Obviously, it just sort of threw a bit of a, like, we're like, well, where to now? Like it threw a bit of a spanner in the works. And again, we're back to like learning and figuring out what to do and next steps and everything. So, you know, I had a few plans, I guess. We had a few plans to sort of that we had to reconsider and yeah, so it's just like we won't say too much because we'll still do that. So we don't want to give that away.
There's so many ways you can go.
Yeah, I know. There's just so many ways. And obviously I want to add, you know, make sure that there's value and utility and we're still navigating that too. And I don't want to make any calls that then take away from those one of one pieces. Mm-hmm. So we're sort of going, be one of ones for the next collection. Really excited, a couple of weeks off, completely different style. I don't want to just be seen doing the same things over and over again. Mm-hmm. And so definitely the third collection is completely different again. And I mean, we haven't even spoken about how many, but I think there will be multiple pieces up for grabs of the same piece of one of 10s or 20s or something in that. So that'll help people get in at a lower price point, which is just something I definitely want to do and make sure that everyone can get the piece that they want. And then everyone's always been like PFP projects, and I've never really found a connection to anything, but I came up with a wild idea and I reckon it might work, so I'll chat to you guys later.
Okay. You heard it here first.
Yeah. So I want this space to be fun. I don't want it to be boring. I don't want anyone to be like, oh, you've just done that because you want to make, you know, and the cash grab is so far from what we started this for. So for me, I started it like I've never had so as much freedom to create as I do now. Like I'm literally just coming up with ideas and creating what I want. So and hopefully that will show in the pieces and it will show in the like collections to come. And yeah, I think we're all having some fun with it, learning along the way and building some cute little communities. And yeah,
that's what I love about the NFT space. So like, for example, people commission you to do work, but
yeah,
it's what they want, whereas this is giving you the ability to create whatever you want.
Yeah,
and someone can resonate with that and yeah, pay what they think it's worth and
what they value it at.
It's
yeah,
just like,
yeah,
it's
which
crazy.
Which is incredible. Mm. Like, it's so cool because I know that not everyone would value it at that.
Yeah.
And it blows, you know, even our minds. Literally. As well. But obviously, you know, that piece is connected to someone and, you know, they'll hold that NFT for years to come or they'll flip it.
Yeah.
I don't actually mind. Like, you know, someone was like, oh, what if like Gary Vee then goes on to sell for like a couple of million and like, you know, you didn't sell it for that initially. I said, well, they believed in me from the start.
Correct.
So like, kudos to them. Like that's their reward then. And the people who do get in now, I hope that there are many, many rewards to come like for that. So, yeah, so it's so cool. It still blows my mind. Like me creating the pieces, I'm still like it's just, but yeah, it'll be interesting to see how the next few go and the response to like the different projects and styles.
I love the whole like accountability to your community as well. Like, for example, they believe in you now and it makes you want to work harder to reward them.
Yes.
For believing in you like from day one, your first ever project. And
that's
why I'm so cool to see like what else we can like push out there.
Yeah.
And just continue to
like
do
you
it.
Guys are so good. You're like, because I'm like, what can we give away? Like, what can we do? Like, what can you guys like just chill? I'm like, no, but like, what, like, utility? Like, how? And like, so just like, if my community is listening to this, like, I'm so aware and I do want to, like, I'm the sort of person, like, Alessandra can vouch for this. If you're like, she works with me and when I get like print orders, I'm like, just put that free one in there and just put that free one in there and give this person that. She's like, do you know them? I'm like, no, like, and she's just like, oh my god, how do you run a business? Like, you're just like constantly like, yeah. So
that's how what makes your business so good, because you're that caring.
Yeah, you're always thinking about the consumer.
Correct, and that's the main thing with NFTs, like, which we've discussed. Like, pretty much, Danielle, you've pretty much started an NFT business now. That's kind of what you are, and your reputation's on the line. You know, if you, for example, in a year's time, just turn around and be like, oh, you know what, stuff this, I can't bother them, I'm out. See you later, everybody. Like that Elon Musk and everything, it's gonna drop in value and your rep and things like that. It's crazy. So like, this is, you know, you're on the line, and all you have to do is just be you.
In for the long game.
Yeah, play the long game. Just be you and just keep doing what you're doing, because there's a reason why you achieved that first result, and I know in 10 years time, 20 years time, you're gonna look back and you're gonna be in a really scary place, because it's you just gotta do you.
Is that a good thing or a bad thing?
No, it's a good thing.
We traded a monster.
Could be like a washed up artist, just, you know,
just like screaming at a wall. like, yeah, like throwing
caged,
paint at it,
caged
just
up
yeah.
In house, like.
No, I think.
Thanks, guys.
I think you've got this. So it's really exciting. How did you find it? Obviously, we're close with Mike and Tuzzy. How'd you guys find it putting it all together?
I think it was pretty fun. Like Danielle's pretty fun to work with. She's very relaxed. Bit ADHD, but
yeah.
Diagnosed, but yeah. People have definitely flagged that with me. Yeah. It's a thing. Yeah.
It was good though. It was pretty hype on auction day. We're like, I think we were like at like 0.4 ETH or something with most of the pieces, and then the last like hour just like popped off.
Went
and
dark.
It was, yeah, we're kind of all in shock.
Yeah. We didn't really know. I think we were all just like, I think you guys expected more emotion out of me too. And I think I was just like,
yeah, she kind of
so
just sit there,
like
sat there.
Quiet. And yeah, it was just like, they're like, do you ever cry? I'm like, not really. So don't expect that one. In movies and like little kids movies I do, but not in general, real life things I don't really. But yeah, no, these, like you guys have all been amazing. But yeah, especially like Mike and Tuzzy, they've filmed everything. And Mike is like, literally on days where my brain wasn't working, he helps like feed like everything to me. So a lot of the videos and the content that you see is literally kudos,
my words.
Kudos to Mike. He should copyright
Danielle's
him.
My puppet.
Yeah. I'm literally just like his puppet. Yeah, I think it's a lot. Like I think if it was, you know, I was solely working on NFTs, but there's so many elements and moving parts to my business and there's always a lot going on, like you guys as well. Like there's so much, you know, you try to just do everything. So they definitely were a massive rock to get me to get me through all the content. And just like when I was freaking out, I'd just text Mike at like all hours of the night and just ask stupid questions. So you're like way more chill than me. You're so calm. I'm like, is Mike all right? I can't tell. He's always the same. Like,
yeah.
Real appreciate the team. Like I said that to you guys, like I wouldn't have been able to do it without. I was still very, like when we first started working together, I had no idea what we were doing. So it was just good. It sort of gave me that path to focus on and also to realize that we had to educate the audience because I would just be like, here's Manatee.
Yeah.
But yeah, we saw like that there was a massive gap there and people were just like, what is it? How do we set these things up? You know, so and we're going to continue to do that. So,
definitely.
Which is key.
Even I think like we're so early, I think, I don't know if I touched on it in this conversation, but Tom Bilyeu, who sold his company for billions of dollars, things like that. He started his own NFT and I'm a part of it, and I don't know. I think he released too many, and they dropped a lot at the start, and there was a lot of backlash. And he came out and said, "Oh, how he's made all these mistakes and things like that." So it's still such an early time, yeah. And we're all still learning. Like there's no one's an expert in this space. Not even the best. You know, that have done whatever, like it's still, there's so much new that's coming out every day, every week, every month, every year. You know, looking off just like and it goes in cycles, like just looking what's pumped from last year and what's coming into this year, there's POAPs.
Yeah.
And there's DAOs, and now photography NFT is starting to come through, and there's just so much that's new and that's going on. So, you know, looking in 2021, you know, NFTs, meme coins, and at the end of the year when Facebook announced the metaverse was really big, you know, that kind of, you know, category. And now there's all these new things that are coming through, like, so just to touch on a few things, probably my favorite, what I'm most excited about is probably DAOs and the power of what they can do. So, you know, whoever doesn't know what a DAO is, it's a decentralized autonomous organization where people come together. And so, for example, and they put like an organization together to then try achieve something. So one of the first examples of this was the Constitution. You were following it. Yeah. I remember you were hot on the heels of it.
I was watching the auction live and I couldn't tell who was winning. And I was, the bid just went like crazier and crazier. And It got to like $43 million they raised.
So what was it?
Like, so they wanted to buy the US Constitution. I think there was like one of 11 still like available to this day, the original one. And it was like some big A3, like you could hardly read the text, but they just wanted to purchase it for the whole like community. Yeah. And the last Twitter post I think they put out before the auction was like they raised $20 million. And then I'm watching the bids keep going up.
Insane.
And I couldn't tell.
48 hours as well.
Yeah, in 48 hours. It was like some ridiculous like achievement. Yeah. The most money raised in like such a short period of time. Like crazy.
Yeah.
And I'm watching the auction. I've got no idea who's like, if we're still in it, because like the last tweet I saw said $20 million and we're now at 42. And then some hedge fund billionaire just managed to obviously dig deeper and bought it for $43 million.
Oh my God.
US dollars as
that's
well.
Wild. So that's like, what, 70?
Yeah, some crazy amount of money.
Yeah, so that was the first example. And now, for example, the Lynx DAO, the one that you wanted to mint, they're buying golf courses.
Yeah, so they want to like change the way golf clubs are run, country clubs, etc. Yeah. So they want to buy a top 100 golf course. I reckon it'll be in America just because that's like where... From there, they want to buy more around the world.
Yeah.
And so the NFT allowed you to have membership into one club or you could buy
some of those memberships are like 300K.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
And I just thought like that was such a cool way to like include people who may not be like into golf or whatever, but through NFTs, I'll maybe like go into it. Like me, for example. And
even some of those memberships, like you have to be on the wait list for your life. So it just gives you like access.
Yeah, literally.
You may never have a chance to actually. Yeah.
So I thought it was super cool and they want to buy more. So like it starts with one and then maybe they'll own every golf course. Who knows? Like you just don't know where it can lead to. And I just thought that was a cool initiative.
It's just the power of people coming together.
Yeah.
Like even
yeah.
Blockbuster DAO. That's the one I'm watching this one. I'm like, I'm in. I'm in on this one. They're coming together to raise, I think they want $5 million and they're going to raise that via NFTs and they're going to buy out Blockbuster to make it a digital channel to take on Netflix.
Wow.
So that is going to be very cool to see if they pull this off and they've got a pretty strong team behind them coming together and forming. So that's going to be interesting. Literally about an hour ago, we came up with a DAO idea and the wheels are in motion. Like, we're going to try do this. Yeah. So, like, we'll see how it goes. But probably by the time this comes out, we'll have much further information if we're going ahead with this or not. Like, if it's possible. But Revolver is up for sale. As a development
Revs.
Site.
Yeah.
Yes.
Like Revs? Revs,
yeah.
Revs. Yeah. So if a developer buys that, Revs is going forever. So we're thinking we put a DAO together, we buy the building.
Keep Revs.
And we keep
save Revs.
Yeah. Save Revs.
Wow.
I know. Yeah.
That was an
hour
ago.
Cool, though.
Yeah.
And like think about how many like Melburnians.
Yeah.
Well, there's 6 million people in Melbourne.
I feel like everyone's been there once in their life.
Yeah.
Like from between 18 to...
Whether it was a good time or not.
Yeah. What happened there stays there, but...
Like I don't really have words for... Yeah. But really, like, yeah.
Yeah, I just thought like it's for sale. Idea. Like we can't... We don't have the cash to buy it, so... Yeah.
How much is it?
Probably 20 million.
I think it's 20 million.
Shit.
So if we can raise, I'm thinking this is all out loud.
Yeah,
this is happening
like,
in motion right now.
Speaking it into existence.
Yeah, we're speaking it into existence. So it's going to be 20 million all up, let's just say. It could be cheaper. I don't know. Stefan's on the phone to the agent trying to find out. So we're in this,
We're figuring
this out. Yeah. So let's just say it's going to cost 20 million, which what would that be? 13 million US? Let's have a look. 20 million.
I just call and be like 15,
20 million USD
crazy.
To AUD.
15, 17, somewhere there.
Is it an American person that owns it?
No, we'd have to sell it on OpenSea via NFTs.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it'd be, we need 14.5 million US. So 14.5 million US, let's just go, I don't know, divide that by 20,000.
I'd just call the agent selling it and just be like, look, I lost like a part of my dignity there at Revolver, so you should discount it a couple of million. Like I know a lot of other people that lost their souls there too. So really just take five off. And then we're down to 15 million.
That's I agree. Well, we've got Stephanie. He's gonna hound them.
Yeah.
I reckon he's going to offer them 9.
I can vouch for that.
Yeah, no, I haven't. Okay,
no. It's an interesting place.
Yeah.
Wow. Oh, yeah. So I think the reason why we came up with this, because it's an icon in Melbourne, and we don't want to lose an icon, and it will happen eventually. Like, all the clubs are going one by one. Mm-hmm. So I don't know. I think this would be really cool. We could probably turn this into something where we keep buying iconic buildings.
And start a movement.
Yeah,
like, correct.
If we want to protect our buildings and our nightlife and
correct.
Like, our culture.
Because even the liquor licenses are harder to get, I've heard Aaron say. It's just becoming like a nightmare to be able to start a club or start a venue.
Yeah, the money and the councils and everything, it's just crazy. They make it so hard so people just don't even.
Literally, so want to preserve, like, and I feel like Melbourne's nightlife is so, like, iconic in Australia.
Of course,
And Revs is iconic around the world.
Yeah.
You got people coming from Europe everywhere, coming and going through Revs. So it starts off here and, like, it can go global. Like, you know what I mean? Like, it's like the golf course. Like, they want to buy one golf course, but the goal is hopefully to own one in each country.
Yeah.
And maybe that's the same thing with Save Revs. So
cool. And I think even as well, like, it would be something, I don't know, they'd be getting rent. So even the people in the DAO, whoever owns an NFT, we could, I don't know, this is all in real time again.
Yeah.
We could set up separate business where they might be able to make income from the rent.
Yeah.
So holding the NFT could, I don't know, give you free access to Revolver or something. That could be another.
Lifetime
access. Here's my NFT. Let me in. So I don't know. It's something that we just came up with an hour ago, but who knows where that can lead? And these are the opportunities. Everything's up for grabs. In NFT world. What other? I think POAPs.
POAPs are cool.
Yeah, proof of attendance protocols.
Yep.
Interesting. Yeah. Very interesting.
A memory or an event?
Yes.
Yeah.
So
it's bizarre, like, but I love it. Yeah. I think it's so cool.
It makes so much sense.
Like a sticker, like, that's mine.
Yeah.
So, like, for example, you could go to, well, if you went to a grand final, then your NFT would be the access, but a lot of people could leave early. So imagine a team 90 points down at halftime. So everyone would have already left. Everyone would have, like, half the team would have already left, half the fans. So imagine that team came back and won, and then for 10 minutes, the club, so let's just say Richmond Football Club beat Essendon, 90 points down at halftime, and they win. For 10 minutes, that club can put on the screen, if you were here at this memory, this is the code to say that you stayed the whole match.
Yeah.
Then people could hold that as a POAP.
Yeah, it's so cool.
Or even this now, if we had this live, if this podcast was live, we could put up and say, hey, for the next 10, 20 minutes, if you're listening to this, the POAP is live now, you can take it. So for the rest of their lives, they'll have it in writing. Well, they'll have a token saying, "Oh, was it at that moment in time?" Weddings.
Yeah.
Well, NFTs could be weddings. Like, invitations could be weddings, but anything could be a pop-up.
Yeah, anything. Visit my studio, or you came to my studio at this opening, or like this party. Like, here you go. Like, here's a pop-up for that memory or event, and which is
insane.
Cool. I've got one pop-up, but it was like a New Year's like day POAP for BTC Markets.
What?
And they're gonna do more. So I was just like, I hopefully want to start collaborating with people on like little POAPs, and they're not as like crazy as like NFT projects, but they're still really cool. So
that's amazing.
So it's just because and that's when I first heard of them. I was like, what's this? And like looked into it, and I was like, oh, that's cool. Like,
really cool.
Really, and you can just it's like limitless, like you can just do anything with them, and it's so fun. And then that's essentially utility as well. Like, you're giving little like add-ons and bonuses here and there, and yeah, really cool.
Well, there's projects they release them slowly, and they say if you collect all the POAPs that they're going to be able to give certain prizes to people. So if someone's been there for 15 weeks or 15 whatever, he's collected 15 of them. The creator can say, okay, you've been literally a supporter from the start. You've been to everything. Here's a special NFT or a special
here's
reward.
This or you won this.
And it's all on the blockchain. It's all verified. So it's crazy. What else are you guys excited about for this year? What do you think? What are some predictions in 2022 for NFTs or crypto? Like what's going to trend?
Well, there's one project I'm excited about, and it's Danielle Weber's second NFT drop.
Yeah.
Shout out.
Yeah.
Nothing else matters. Yeah.
Good call, Mike. Yeah. Safe call.
Thanks, mate.
Safe call. 10 points.
Yeah. Gotta stay on brand.
Yeah.
Nah, thanks, guys. I'm excited for all. I have so many ideas and so many hours in a day, so I'm just gonna chug along and hopefully be able to, I guess, put out what I want to and keep going and keep learning. Crypto is a bit of a funny one at the moment. It's like the longest cycle for a while. I don't know the correct terminology. I still don't. So look at me go. Look at me now. So crypto, I don't know. Like I'm not getting too excited with crypto because I think it's a little bit strange at the moment with what's going on. We're still hoping for a bull run that hasn't happened. So no expectations there.
I think we're in a bull run. We've been in a bull run all 2021.
I know. Like, but it's just like
just a little bit of. There's been a few corrections, but
yeah. So I don't really understand what's going on there, and just sort of like chugging along, and I think I'll just put my energy into NFTs. So, but yeah, just excited to see more and more big companies and corporations adapting and integrating this into their businesses moving forward, and other artists seeing that it's possible to do that, and just diversifying and getting involved. Like I think a lot of people just sort of stay back, which is so fair, and just wait to see if it's something that will work. And sometimes play the safe game, which is so fine. And I'm happy to always be like, I'll be the guinea pig. And I hope they can see that, you know, it is worth it. It's not always about making money. It's literally about, you know, being able to create what you want to create and being rewarded for it as well. So money's excited cool, about though. That. What'd you say?
Money's cool.
Money's cool though. Well, it gives you that freedom. Like it's given me freedom to go and like buy into projects. Like I didn't withdraw any of the money that I got from my first drop. I have literally just bought back into projects and sort of played around a little bit more freely, I guess, because I'm just like, well, yeah, like that's
we got some funds.
Yeah. So thanks, guys.
All you smashed it.
Can I just say though, which I forgot to mention before, kudos to Mike and Twizzy because they literally were so honest with my pieces. Like when I was finishing the first two collections, Mike is like so honest. He was just like, oh, I don't like that. You need to fix that. That's not finished. So like I can give credit to the boys because they were like, put that there. I haven't given you a solid mention. So Twizzy and
Thank you.
Twizzy and Mike, they were Snoop Dogg has yellow sunnies. He chose the yellow sunnies. Like, there's a few little additions on other pieces as well. And he's just doing a victory dance over there. Yeah.
It's all you, Tizzy.
Yeah. I forgot to say that before. Anyway, sorry. Over to you, Michael. What are you looking forward to?
Pretty much every week, like, something new happens in the space. Like, it's actually crazy how much the technology and the adoption just changes every week.
Yeah.
Like, you look at the first projects to the current ones, like, staking is now a thing. It changes so much. I think play to earn games are my my favorite thing. I think, or the thing I'm most excited for.
That's gonna be big this year.
I think if a game can come out that's more like suited to what I like, I'm like diving headfirst into that and like aping in as hard as anyone else will be.
Yeah. That's cool.
But yeah, besides that, DAOs as well. DAOs, yep. I think just the whole movement.
It's cool.
I love the community. Like NFTs have created like such a positive mindset compared to like just other places. Like COVID is such a like a depressing topic, but you go on Twitter and everyone's like positive, happy, optimistic, all that kind of stuff. So DAOs and play to earn games are definitely my favorite and most excited thing.
Yeah, I think NFT photography is going to be very interesting. I've been trying to dive into it a little bit. I've got a massive list of heaps of photographers. I don't really know how to kind of split between who's an amazing photographer and who's not. So I'm kind of just I'm kind of just going with what I feel like. I've bought a few. I bought an Aussie, which I just supported because he was in Gold Coast, and I was like, this is really cool. What's his name?
Is it the Beach Ones?
The Beach Ones. Yes.
I've seen them. Yeah.
Yes.
Amazing. I can't remember the name of them, but they're so cool.
What's his name? I don't even know. Yeah, a lot of it's Gab's Beach Club.
Yes. Gab's That's Beach really Club. Cool. They're like drone shots too.
Yeah.
Is it landscape? Like Aussie landscape? Or is it?
Beach. And
I don't know. Yeah.
Yeah,
I
like overhead. Like yeah. Big drone shots, like aerial.
Yeah. So he released four of them, like four photos. Yeah. I think, yeah. That's really cool. So, and I'm just trying to find a lot of Melbourne photographers. I want to try and support. I've met someone that showed me a fair few. I haven't bought any yet, but I want to try and get around that. So I think that's kind of my focus as well. But yeah, it's just all like you said. It's moved so fast, but you have to be on Twitter. I think that's the biggest
you
thing.
You guys are like, get on Twitter.
Yeah.
Like, I joined in like 2015 or something.
Yeah.
Like it says when.
Yeah, same. Yeah, I used to go
like
for soccer.
Ages ago and I never really got into it. And nah, me either. Now I actually am really enjoying Twitter.
It's my favorite platform.
It's still like a bit full on. Like I'm like, where is that going? Like where's that from? And I keep retweeting the wrong things. But anyways, like, but yeah, Twitter's definitely like the space.
Yeah. Twitter, if you're not on crypto or NFT Twitter, then you're not in the space. That's what I say. Because it's like, it's where the degens.
I do
the,
a little like consumption. Can you guys go follow me on Twitter? Because I got like 400. Really just lagging behind.
We'll get there. Oh man, I just love following all different people. Yeah, so I haven't really tweeted. I've only been tweeting like the last month, like a few things, nothing crazy. So I've got like 100 followers and I'm following like 1,000. But I don't even care because I just love it. Like there's so many amazing people to learn from or just so many amazing minds. And like you said, I think that's the main thing. Like the crazy thing like I've seen through like Instagram and all this stuff, everyone's just trying to flex. Everyone's trying to show some imaginary life that they live. That's just bullshit. I'm not saying it doesn't happen on Twitter, but Twitter's just all positive. Like everyone's just trying to help each other. Everyone's just like, hey, look at this because it's, you know, or people coming together that they, you know, through projects that they have certain interests in, which is amazing. So I don't know. I think, go on Twitter.
Discord and Twitter.
Yeah.
Get it.
But I think that this literally concludes the first episode. I hope you guys enjoyed it. Does anyone really want to add anything else? Does anyone want to say anything? We're going to be doing this weekly. So even if you have, you know, the audience listening, if you have any questions, we can answer some questions every week. Yeah. Bloody oath. But anything to conclude, or do you think we've covered everything?
Just a prediction.
Prediction, okay.
Apes to 100 ETH by the end of the year.
Oof.
Yeah, I believe it. Yeah. I'm with that.
Don't have an ape, but I believe in the apes.
Yeah, I believe that. Well, let's all give a prediction then. I don't know. My prediction is Dogecoin is going to be the currency of the world in 10 years' time. With the US/Australian dollar, we're not cutting out.
I'm waiting.
Yeah, we're not cutting out the dollar. Like people are still going to trade in fiat. So when I say that, I'm just going to add that. But I believe Elon Musk is going to take this and make it a currency. So that's my crazy prediction. 10 years' time.
What's your prediction, Danielle?
Poor predictions. That most companies that you know by the end of this year would have started or either have already dabbled in NFTs some way, shape or form.
Yep. Yes. That's a good one.
Kind of there.
We're still early. Still very early. Still, it's
like Nike and Macca's.
Yeah, like they're the big ones, but there's still a fair few.
Yeah.
Like, why haven't I heard you do it? Like there's still,
a lot of them.
In all fields, like just across the board.
You can understand a lot of them, like for example, corporations like Disney and stuff like that, Harry Potter, they're just waiting on the sidelines, Pokemon, to see how it plays out.
So have the AFL done anything yet?
They're coming.
Yeah.
I probably think they're going to launch, I would have thought this season. Like, I know they've done a partnership, but I don't know when they're going to launch.
What do you know?
Yeah.
No, so we'll see. I think, like, definitely by the end of the year, there's a lot of people who are still like, oh, no, like, what are NFTs? Like, I think they will start to realize it shouldn't take for all your favorite companies and corporations and food chains and everything for them to jump on board for you to believe in it. But I think that once everyone starts seeing that, they'll be like, oh shit, this is real. Like this is here to stay. Yeah.
I think I'd say we're at the point of like people, like they know like they've heard, they obviously have heard what an NFT is, and they're kind of starting to understand, but we're still very early.
Everyone's still putting it in the too hard basket, I reckon.
Yeah, like it's still very early. A lot of people don't believe it. Like even gaming, like game. So the first AAA game, Ubisoft, came out and they're launching NFTs for their game, and the gamers, like the core gamers, are against it.
Yeah.
And that blows my mind that they're against it, because it's like, I will use me as an example. I've over the years probably spent thousands, not tens of thousands, but thousands on Ultimate Team cards.
Yeah.
And I used to play FIFA a lot, and knowing that after that year, the game like changes, and then all that money I've paid, I don't get those NFTs. So where if they were NFTs, I'd be able to on-sell them or things like that. So, and the same thing with skins. A lot of people pay a lot of money for Call of Duty skins. So it baffles me that the gaming community don't want NFTs, because it's their currency. So we're early, very early.
Yeah, I think especially with what the gaming world is going to be doing for third world countries as well, I think that will come more into play, and then people will start to know that, you know, it is more beneficial across the board.
Well, when they make, I think gaming, when they make money.
But giving some control back to third world countries, and people are now able to earn and from gaming.
Crazy.
That's really cool.
Literally. Cool. Sumu, what's your, do you have a prediction?
I don't have a prediction, but I have some advice. I think it's important for anyone who's watching who doesn't know about this space, get educated. You need to keep up. Otherwise, you'll fall behind. And if you fall behind, you'll just be left in the dust. Just like the people who didn't embrace the internet and everything like that. Like NFTs weren't even a thing 2 years ago. And now they're like this massive market.
Yeah.
Same with crypto. It wasn't a thing 10 years ago. But so, yeah, like just with anything that comes up, take it with an open mind and you might make yourself some money.
Bloody oath. Or start a business. There's so much. Like everything's up for grabs in this space. So thanks, guys.
Well, my financial advice.
Yeah.